Hello there, Goobers, and welcome back to our dialogue system created using GameMaker Studio 2. Today we're going to be adding portraits and names for who is currently speaking. To start with, we've added a couple more assets to our asset browser over here. We have a new font. This is the font that we're going to use as we display the name of who's speaking. And I also have some portrait sprites. So this sprite is used as the backdrop for our portraits. I also have a few character sprites that I can use as examples when we create some testing dialogue later on. I have the same character with two different emotions as well, so we can demonstrate a character just changing their facial expressions and not changing like the entirety of who is currently speaking. And lastly, we have a new sprite here that will act as the backdrop for our name. This is also a 9-slice, like the text box sprite. So this can stretch and it can grow without distorting the sides. And it's just going to act like a little scroll-looking background that we'll write our names on top of. To get started, we're going to go to our text box object, and we're going to define some new variables in our create event. We'll start by adding some portrait variables. We're going to define where we are putting the portrait, the x and y position, and then we'll add some speaker variables. So the speaker position, the font that the name is going to be written in, and the color that the font is going to be. We also need some not customizable variables, so I'm going to go to our private properties section and add some more down here. First, some private portrait variables, the sprites that the portrait is going to be using, and the width and the height. We also need a variable that tracks which side of the text box the portrait is on, because we want to be able to put our portrait on the left or the right side of the text box. And to do that, we're going to use an enumerator. If you don't know what an enumerator is, it's basically a custom defined value. So we've created our left and right value, and we're setting the portrait side variable here to start on the left. And we also need some private speaker variables. So what name we're going to be drawing in our name box, and the width and the height as well. And those are all of the variables that we need to create to set up our portrait and our name features. So now we can move on to the other events. We don't need to change anything in the step event because everything we're doing right now is purely visual. So we can go immediately to the draw GUI event. And to start this off, we're actually going to first, make some temporary variables, draw text X, draw text Y, draw text width, and we're going to replace some of the arguments we put down here with these variables. And the reason why we're doing this is because when our portrait draws itself in the text box, it's going to shift where our text draws, and it's also going to affect how much width the text has to type itself in. So we need the text to be aware of any changes that the portrait might or might not make. So we need these temporary variables to track those changes. We're also going to need to know if we have finished typing out a page of text or not, because we're going to be adding an animation. The character is going to be playing a talking animation while the text types, and it's going to be still while the text is not typing. So we need to know if that animation needs to be playing or not. You can see here, my example sprites have a small talking animation. So that'll play while the text is typing. And this variable is also going to be used later for other things too. For example, when we add in a choice system, we only want to present choices when text is finished typing out. So we'll be using this variable again in that situation. It's good to just get this now so that we have it for all of our coming features. Having a portrait is optional, so we're going to check if we've actually set a portrait or not before we draw it. If we don't have a portrait sprite set, then we skip over all of this and we just draw our text the way we used to draw it. When we do have a portrait, we need to shrink the area the text can draw itself in, and it doesn't really matter which side the portrait is on, the text's width is going to shrink by the same amount. So we can do this unconditionally. We don't need to check if it's on the left or right side for this part. Similarly to what we did with the text variables, we're going to make some temporary portrait variables as well, because there are going to be multiple things that we draw, and we want to reference that position a few times. So I'm going to declare draw portrait X, draw portrait Y, and draw portrait X scale as well. We're going to flip the direction the portrait faces depending on whether it's on the left or right. So that's why we have this variable too. When our portrait is on the left side, we don't need to move it from this position we defined, but we do need to move the text. So if our portrait side is the left side, then we're going to move our text position over by the width of the portrait plus any extra room that it takes up. So this will make sure that our text always starts to the right of the portrait when it's on the left side. When our portrait is on the right side, we don't need to move the text position, but we do need to move the portrait position to be over on the right side of the text box. And we also want to flip our X scale to -1 so that it faces to the left. Now that we know where the portrait is going, we can draw sprite portrait, which is just like that backing sprite that we have, at our portrait position. And now we need to determine whether or not our portrait is animating, and if it is, what frame of animation should it be using. So I'm going to add a slightly complex line of code now. We're making a sub-image temporary variable, and if we haven't finished typing our text out, we're going to set our sub-image depending on how much text we've typed out, relative to how fast the text types out, and also taking into account how fast our portrait sprite animates. So mine, for example, animate at 5 frames per second, but if I did something like 20, I mean, that's crazy fast, but it would animate this fast if I set my sprite to this speed. I'm going to make it a bit more reasonable and set it to 5 frames per second instead. And with all that set up, we can now draw the actual portrait sprite itself. So I'm going to use DrawSpriteEXT so that I can affect the X scale. I'm drawing our portrait sprite using the sub-image that we defined above. At the draw portrait position, I'm adding half of the portrait width and height because my portrait back sprite is top left aligned, whereas my portrait sprites have a centered origin. And you may wish to do this differently. Maybe you'd rather put your portrait origins at the top left too. But personally, I like knowing where the middle of my portrait is. Now let's draw the name of who's speaking. This is once again optional, so we're only going to do this if we've actually set a speaker name. And the size of our name box depends on the size of the text that it's drawing. So if we have an especially wide name, then we need to stretch our name box to fit. So we're going to take the maximum of either the width of our text or the width of our name box sprite. Whichever's wider is the width we're going to use. Then we'll draw that stretched out name box sprite using draw sprite stretched. We're just drawing it at the speaker position. You can see I'm also subtracting half of the speaker height as well. And this is just going to make it so that speaker Y points to the center of our name box. So when we draw the name as text, we'll put it right in the center. Now we just need to draw that text. So first we're going to set some of the text property variables. We set our H-align and V-align to both be centered. We're setting the fonts to the font we defined in our create events, setting our color. We're putting our text right in the middle of the name box horizontally. And as we said before, speaker Y is the middle vertically, so we're putting it at Y plus speaker Y, and we're just drawing the name. And that's all of the code that needs to go into our text box object. Now let's add a dialog action so that we can define portraits and names in our actual dialog data. So let's go over to script actions, where we put our text dialog action, and we're going to add a new dialog action, this time the speaker action. You can see this one takes a name, and it also optionally takes a sprite and a side. So you always specify who's talking, but you can also specify what they look like and what side of the text box they're on. Inside the act method for speaker action, we're always going to set our speaker name equal to the name that we passed in. And if we specified a sprite, then we're going to set the portrait sprite variable. And if we defined a side, then we're going to set our portrait side variable. And the last thing to do here is to call textbox.next inside our act method. In the last video, we talked about textbox.next and how it's the method that you call to advance to the next page. We want to make sure that happens automatically when you set a speaker, because we don't want the player to have to press the space bar just because you've set who's talking. You want to also automatically see what they're saying too. So we need to automatically go to the next action and also type out the text that follows our speaker action. So note that we're not calling textbox.next in our text action, because that writes out a page of text and we want the player to actually read that text and press spacebar to go past it. But we are calling it in speaker action because we want this to automatically move on to writing a page of text. Real quick, just like we did with our text action, we're going to make a new macro, just a speaker macro, and this will just make it a little more convenient to add in speakers and portraits to our dialogue data. So that's all the code we need to write. So let's test it out. Let's go over to our topic script and let's add in a portrait and a name to our example dialogue. So first, I'm just going to create a new topic featuring some dialogue between two different characters. So this will be our first character talking, then our second character, and then our first character will say two pages of text. So to identify who's talking and what they look like, we're just going to add some speaker commands before each page of text. For this example, the first speaker is going to be Sam. I'm going to use my Sam portrait sprite, and I'm going to put this portrait on the left side. Then I'm going to make the next speaker Rudy. I'm going to use my Rudy portrait, and they'll be on the right side. Then we'll swap back to the Sam sprite and name. And for the second page of text in this couplet, I'm going to change the portrait that they use. So I'm going to use the Mad sprite here. But you can see that I'm not adding in a side argument to here. When you leave out the portrait side argument, then the portrait will just stay on whatever side it's currently on. So we just want to leave it on the left side. And so now we have our dialogue written out, and let's just use the good morning topic when we test with our demo object. So when we start dialogue, I'm going to use our good morning dialogue instead of the example dialogue. Let's test it out. We'll hit play. Now you may notice something not right as we test this, but the first page looks pretty good. We've got our portrait, we've got our name, and the text is shifted over to the right to make room for the portrait. But if you go to the next page, with a portrait on the right side, our text now is overlapping with the name because it's not being shifted to the right anymore. So this is just a positioning issue, and we can really quickly fix this. If we just head on back to our text box object, and we just have to edit the text y variable that we created that defines the y position of our text. So I could change this to padding times 3, for example, and that'll just push our text down a little bit further. So let's try this new version out. And you can see the text is already a bit lower now. And now it no longer overlaps with the name. So now our text nicely meshes. And you can even see that as the text width decreased, now our text wrapping makes sure that we don't spill over any further. If our text started all the way on the left side, then today would be on the first line, but now it's no longer able to fit because of the portrait, so it dropped a line correctly. And with that, we've successfully created our portrait and our name features for our dialogue system. And hopefully you can see with that little tweak at the end that customizing where things go and editing how our text box looks isn't so hard. Because we took the time to create these customizable variables that are very descriptive and control the visual aspects of our dialogue system, we are now able to very, very easily change those values to whatever we need. Thanks for watching. I hope this helped. So long.